changes in the climate elements, in terms of precipitation, in terms of humidity, in terms of temperature. All this combines together to change the climate as we used to know it. The World Health Organization has described climate change as the most significant health challenge in the 21st century. They also, that's the World Health Organization, also describe climate change as a threat that is rampant and it is threatening a lot of the advances that we have made in healthcare system globally and in Africa as well. For me, I describe climate change as a burden amplifier and an ill health potentiator. It is amplifying the burden of health that we are facing, and it is potentiating our ill health. First, because of the adverse weather conditions that we see and disasters that are rampant as a consequence of climate change, there is more susceptibility to disasters happening, which result in injuries, result in deaths, result in loss of properties, and all these have health consequences on our people globally. There is also emergence and spread of infectious diseases, including diseases that were hitherto on the way to getting eliminated or eradicated. We're now seeing increased risk of emerging and re-emerging infectious diseases fueled by changing in the ecosystem and the forced close interaction between man and animal. As an example, Ebola or Lassa fever, schistosomiasis, yellow fever, even the popular malaria. Climate change is resulting in resurgence and increased incidence of those diseases. And we are also having situations where, in areas where malaria is not known, malaria is showing there because of the change in climate, because of the increase in temperature. We also have increase in illnesses that are aggravated by air pollution and airborne allergens, such as asthma, bronchitis, and emphysema. We have health impacts from heat waves and unblemished storms. Climate change is also altering the risk of non-communicable diseases by potentiating risk factors like diet, because when there's climate change and there's food insecurity, people eat what they see. And that also potentiates the risk factor for non-communicable diseases. When the environment changes, it also affects the risk factor for non-communicable diseases. And of course, climate change also potentiates mental illnesses like depression, like schizophrenia, because somebody who has suffered disaster, maybe lost property, lost investments of several years, is at risk, susceptible for developing mental illnesses. And of course, our health system is overburdened. Africa is particularly vulnerable to the effects of climate change on health, because of our high poverty rates, like I mentioned, our weak health system. There's also armed conflicts in several parts of our continent, which is also potentiating the effects of climate change on our health. We also have limited capacity, limited infrastructure, which are also constituting additional health challenges. Researches have shown that one, cholera epidemiological patterns demonstrate a clear association between sea temperature and cholera incidences. As an example, in Lagos, Nigeria, in 2017, when we had the flood disaster of 2017, we witnessed 50% of hospitalization, which were due to waterborne diseases such as cholera and typhoid. Research has also shown that cases of food poisoning due to Salmonella and other bacteria tend to go up 1 to 6 weeks after reported increased ambient temperature. Cases of waterborne diseases like giardiasis is also increasing following heavy downpours. Climate change affects the life cycle and spread of vector-borne diseases, just as the West Nile virus, the equine encephalitis, Lyme disease, the hantavirus disease, and also malaria. We also see increasing incidence of foodborne diseases, because when we have flooding, there is the likelihood that, or increased likelihood that fresh food will get contaminated with feces, and that can lead to foodborne infections. Shellfish poisoning has also been found in some locations to be strongly linked to rising ambient temperature. By and large, the developed world is faced as a result of climate change with increasing burden of infectious diseases that were previously considered eliminated, while Africa has to battle with further increase in the hitherto highly bordersome infectious disease like cholera, typhoid fever, and diarrhea diseases, vector-borne diseases like malaria, and zoonotic diseases like Ebola and Lassa fever. Climate change is undermining the dramatic progress that have been made in Africa and indeed in sub-Saharan Africa in reducing the loss of life from many types of communicable disease conditions that are affecting early childhood, especially diarrhea diseases and lower respiratory infection. Going forward, therefore, I would like to echo the common African position for climate change and health. One, the ministers of environment and ministers of health must work together to protect Africans from the anticipated negative health consequences of climate change. There's a need for us as Africans to adopt a holistic and interdisciplinary approach to health, the One Health approach that recognizes the interconnectivity of human health, animal health, and environmental health need to be emphasized. In Nigeria, we have committed to institutionalizing the One Health approach, and we recently inaugurated the Ministerial Steering Committee on One Health. There's a need for increased investment in overall health and related infrastructure development in Africa. Globally, only about 0.5% of multilateral climate finance has been attributed to health projects. More financial resources should be committed to greening our health, building resilience in the health, creating early warning systems, and research to better understand the impact of climate change on health in Africa and to develop new pharmaceutical products. There's also a need for us to take seriously nature-based solutions, which is God's gift, African gift to the world, like afforestation, like restoring ecosystems, like improving degraded habitats, mangrove restoration, and greening our diet. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Salako, for speaking to us around the Nexus. And I did request, I know we have a bigger panel. I did request Dr. Collins, the Minister for Environment, if you are in, you can join us. Natasha, please, AGN, you can also join us. As they come up front, I know when we were having the discussion during the African Climate Summit, most of the speakers, and particularly Dr. Gitahi here, was very concerned about how the ministers of environment and health are working together. And I think increasingly, Dr. Gitahi, you can agree with me that now we are seeing more of that happening with Dr. Salako here speaking to us around that nexus and some of the key things that are happening. So when we did the African Common Position workshop in Malawi, we were hosted by the Minister for Health, Honorable Kadondo, who is here with us today, and she's the best person placed to speak to us about that position, and how the Ministry of Health can even advance, can play a greater role in terms of advancing that common position. Please, let's welcome Honorable Kadondo to speak to us. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having this opportunity to speak on this very important topic. This is such a historic day in the history of COP that for the first time, health is being recognized as one of the sectors which really has suffered because of climate change. Unfortunately, it is happening on the 28th COP. It means we have missed 27 opportunities where I would have done something, where I would have addressed some of the issues, and maybe would not have reached the stage where we are. But still, we are happy, and we are so thankful to the organizers for including the Health Day. Why is it that we are insisting that health should be part of the conversation? We are insisting that health should be part of the conversation because we are one of the sectors who really have suffered. We have heard from the Honorable Minister of Environment. So many issues about cyclones all over in Africa. In Malawi, we had the worst cyclone this year, which affected over 2 million Malawians. We lost lives. So many people lost lives. So many people lost their livelihood. So many people lost their homes as well. We have farmers. Malawi is agro-based economy. We had some farmers who really had already planted their crops. Everything was washed away. We are having droughts. Droughts is causing malnutrition. When we had made so much gains in terms of bringing down the levels of malnutrition in our communities, but now because of drought, because of the cyclones, malnutrition is happening again. The numbers are going up of our children, having malnutrition. And it is the health sector which we have to attend to it. The Honorable Minister of Environment also talked about cholera. We had the worst case of cholera outbreak in Malawi, which lasted almost a whole year. Even up to now, it's still there. We're having two or three cases. We lost almost 2,000 Malawians to cholera, a cholera which was happening even during summer, unheard of. Things like those. We are having vector migration. We are seeing mosquitoes which we have never seen before, even bigger. We distribute mosquito nets in Malawi to all pregnant women. But these mosquitoes, they are biting you during the day. It means the mosquito nets are not working. It's not a solution. So that is why we're saying, no, something is wrong here. What is happening? How come this malaria, it is now being resistant to what was working? So we are saying we are in a crisis. And if we are not careful, as countries, or indeed as a whole world, we are going to lose the gains which we had made, especially in the health sector. We had issues like HIV, tuberculosis, malaria. Now things will look much, much, much better. Unfortunately, it is the women, the babies, who we have saved from dying from HIV AIDS, only to lose them to effects of climate change. What are we doing? We have already invested a lot. So we are saying, no, health has to be part of this very important conversation on issues of climate change. What is it that we have to do? When people are sick, they come to the hospital. Whether it's a cyclone, you are injured, you come to the hospital. Whatever happens, you come to the hospital. People are getting strange skin cancers. They need the health sector. So many things. Unfortunately, the most who are suffering, it is us from the low-income countries. And these are the countries who really, our contribution to climate change effects is very, very minimal. The people who are suffering in Malawi because of climate change, some of them, they have never even driven, they don't even own a car. They have not contributed anything. But the ones who are contributing to the pollution and everything else, they are up there. So there is a dislink. So we are saying, no, we need to be part of it. And also one of the issues which we stress is that in our individual countries, ministers of health were not part of the climate conversation. And we can attest to that. When they came to Malawi for the climate summit, the question was asked, how many ministers of health are involved in the climate conversation in countries? None of us. So now it is a rare opportunity whereby we have to work. We have work in our own countries so that as ministries, this is multisectoral. Health has to be part of it, gender has to be part of it, education has to be part of it, finance has to be part of it. Because whatever we have to do, the interventions, the strategies which we have to use, we need the resources. And that is where we bring in our partners. We are happy that they say that funding is not a problem in the climate sector. But it is unlocking. We want funding which is accessible. Funding which is not just on paper to say we're pledging 100 million for Malawi, Zambia, Zimbabwe, South Africa, whatever, just on paper. And then you go on the ground, not even a penny, you can trace it. We want flexible funding. We want funding with the conditions which really are helpful. Because some of the conditions just to access even a dollar, you spend so much over maybe 2 or 3 years without even accessing even a dollar. Conditions which really, they're so rigid. We do not want that. So to me, I'm summarizing now. What we are looking for, I hope, are concrete action, concrete outcomes, tangible outcomes from this summit. It will not be good. We have met here. All of us were excited. Come next year, what have I achieved? Nothing. Nothing. You know, some of us, we have really sacrificed just to be here. But we want outcomes. We want to create, we want to establish climate smart health systems. We need infrastructure. We need to strengthen our health system so that, you know, the climate resilient. But for that to happen, it will require all of us. It will require governments. It will require civil society groups. It will require our partners. It will require, you know, African CDC, African Union. We are happy that WHO, we're already working together. Even UN, it is a collective responsibility. Because sometimes we don't want to act because it's not happening. Other countries, they'll say, no, we are done with malaria. But the way things are, don't be surprised that maybe in 5 years' time, you'll find that in UK, there is malaria. It will happen if we don't do anything about it now. So we are appealing. This is a call to action. This is the time for action. This is not the time for promises, for just commitments. No, this is the time for action. So we need action, action, action. Otherwise, if we don't do that, all of us were already affected. But we don't want to lose one more life, no, when we can do something about it. Once again, thank you so much for the invitation, but also for allowing me to share the Malawi story. Thank you.
Thank you so much, the Honorable Minister, for sharing some of those perspectives on how the ministries of health can even play a greater role at the national level in terms of climate and health work. So thank you so much, Madam, for speaking to us. Now, I want next to invite His Excellency Prosper Dodiko, who is the Minister for Environment, Agriculture and Livestock for Burundi, and just to share with us some of the lessons, because part of what we need to learn from and build on the learning curve is part of what is working in some of our countries. And so I want to invite him to speak to us about what is working in Burundi and the efforts they are putting in around integrating climate and health at the national level, whether it's policy or advocacy or just frameworks or just actual work that is happening in that country. So welcome, Your Excellency.
Thank you very much for this opportunity, but I apologize because my English is very bad. I am fluent in French. That is why I ask you to allow me to speak in French. Mesdames, Messieurs les ministres, ici présents, Mesdames, Messieurs, tout protocole observé, bon après-midi. Je suis heureux de l'invitation que vous nous avez envoyée pour partager l'expérience du Burundi en matière d'intégration des changements climatiques et de la santé dans les plans de développement. Et pour vous donner cette expérience, je vais relier les changements climatiques, l'eau et la sécurité alimentaire. Quand on parle de changement climatique, on a trouvé que le facteur déterminant est l'eau. Quand vous avez beaucoup d'eau, vous avez les inondations, vous avez l'érosion, et vous avez aussi la prolifération des maladies. Et quand on ne fait pas attention, on risque de tomber dans une situation difficile à gérer. Prenons le cas de l'excès de l'eau. Si vous ne protégez pas l'environnement, vous ne tracez pas les courbes de niveau, vous ne plantez pas les arbres, c'est-à-dire que les sols vont être érodés et il y aura érosion. Quand il y a érosion, c'est-à-dire qu'il y a perte de la fertilité des sols. Et quand il y a la perte de la fertilité des sols, vous avez la diminution de la production. Et quand vous avez la diminution de la production agricole, vous commencez à observer des maladies liées à des carences. Et donc, finalement, le changement climatique est directement lié à la santé. Quand il n'y a plus de production suffisante, quand il n'y a plus de diversification des aliments, c'est à ce moment qu'on constate à avoir des maladies carencières. Et là, nous avons compris que si on ne fait pas attention à la lutte contre le changement climatique, si on n'augmente pas la production, il doit y avoir des répercussions directes sur la santé. Prenons l'exemple. Au niveau de la production, il est difficile de parler de la protection de l'environnement si vous n'avez pas donné suffisamment à manger. Parce que la production agricole, c'est elle qui va donner la force à la population pour travailler à la protection de l'environnement. Mais quand les gens n'ont pas suffisamment à manger, non seulement qu'ils vont tomber malades, mais également, il doit y avoir diminution du travail que cette population devrait effectuer. Ça, c'est d'un seul côté. Mais aussi, à la santé, les centres de santé doivent utiliser l'énergie. Et quelquefois, si on ne fait pas attention, il y en a ceux qui utilisent l'énergie pour la cuisson, on utilise le bois, et on utilise aussi le pétrole ou les énergies fossiles. Et ça a un impact direct sur la gestion des ressources naturelles. C'est ainsi que nous, dans notre pays, nous avons développé un programme des énergies solaires pour les distribuer au centre de santé afin d'éviter que même pendant la cuisson, on n'utilise pas du bois. C'est-à-dire que quand vous avez l'énergie solaire, on peut l'utiliser soit pour la cuisson, on peut aussi l'utiliser pour d'autres activités. Et finalement, non seulement l'énergie, mais aussi nous avons compris que même le transport, ça marche avec le changement climatique. Toujours quand vous avez l'excès de l'eau, il y a les infrastructures de transport qui en périssent. Et donc, nous avons compris que lors de la planification, non seulement que nous devons impliquer les services de la santé, nous devons aussi impliquer les services de l'énergie et de transport. C'est ça ce que nous avons appelé un plan multi-acteur, un plan multi-sectoriel. C'est-à-dire que c'est un plan où la planification doit tenir compte de toutes les facettes de la vie nationale. Et c'est ainsi que dans notre plan, même si c'est un ministère de l'Environnement, vous allez trouver qu'il existe des projets dans les documents, les projets en matière de distribution des énergies solaires au niveau des centres de santé. Vous allez trouver que pour protéger les routes que notre ministère va construire, nous sommes obligés de tracer les courbes de niveau afin d'éviter que les infrastructures routières ne soient pas endommagées. Nous sommes obligés aussi de travailler avec le ministère en charge de l'énergie parce que nous sommes obligés de faire une transition vers l'énergie renouvelable. Et donc, nous devons avoir un lien fort entre la production suffisante des aliments pour donner une meilleure santé à la population. Nous devons aussi travailler sur la protection de tous les bassins versants pour éviter que les infrastructures ne soient pas emportées par l'érosion. Nous sommes également obligés de travailler avec les industriels pour les aider à transformer les déchets afin d'avoir aussi une autre sorte d'énergie. Et finalement, à une conclusion simple, on peut affirmer que le changement climatique, c'est un facteur transversal. Pour la santé, il y a des maladies qui sont causées par l'insuffisance de l'eau. Et là, le changement climatique joue un rôle important. Non seulement les maladies, mais aussi au niveau de la consommation de l'énergie. Et finalement, pour un beau plan de développement du ministère de l'Environnement, il est important de prendre en considération les besoins des autres parce que leur effet impacte sur tout ce qu'on développe. Et donc, au Burundi, nous avons eu cette chance de travailler avec les autres ministères pour avoir un plan multi-acteur et multi-sectoriel. Et ça, nous avons même intégré le partenariat public et privé où, non seulement dans un projet de protection de l'environnement, nous injectons des activités génératrices de revenus. Vous allez trouver que dans un projet de protection de l'environnement, vous allez trouver la distribution des énergies renouvelables, vous allez trouver les projets d'aménagement hydro-agricole, vous allez trouver les centrales qui produisent de l'énergie. Tout cela, c'est pour diminuer l'impact que l'homme effectue sur l'environnement. Et antake ministre de l'environnement, je dois me rassurer que tous les acteurs autour de moi nous acheminons vers le même objectif, c'est-à-dire, un, d'abord, trouver à manger à une population sans cesse croissante, deux, produire d'une manière durable, éviter que mon secteur empiétine les autres et éviter aussi que les autres secteurs empiétinent sur les ressources naturelles. Je vous remercie. Et si vous permettez, parce qu'il y a un autre événement important, parce que le Burundi assure la présidence de la commission des forêts de l'Afrique centrale, il y a une intervention et je vais m'excuser parce que je dois y aller tout de suite. Merci beaucoup.
Thank you so much, Honorable Minister, for sharing with us some of the innovations that are happening in the Republic of Burundi, and we thank you for your time. I know we've had a number of government ministers speaking to us, and some of us are asking ourselves, where is the voice of civil society? Is it just a government issue? What is civil society doing in Africa? And when we were in Malawi, many of the actions were being driven also by the civil society. I think we had Pakcha leading the team, AMREF was there, AFIDEP, and several of the civil societies, you know, that were in Malawi to craft the common position. So, Dr. Mithika, please, can you tell us what has been the role of civil society and how can they even do more to advance this position going forward?
So, thank you. Thank you very much, moderator. And I'll stand by existing protocols. First and foremost, I want really to thank our senior government officials for gracing this event, and also extend my also appreciation of the partners which we have been working on this initiative, which we started as early as March this year in Malawi, particularly AMREF, AFINDEP, the government of Malawi, and all those we have been working with. And so, I will not render any statement. Mine is just a provocation, and because we, as in the climate constituency, have been working on this area for a long time. We have worked cross-sectoral, and the sector which has missed in this space is the health sector. And particularly, when we adopted the Paris Agreement in 2015 in France, the spirit was to trickle down the discourse on climate change from that superstructure, stratosphere, to where action is to the people. And there were two things. One, sectoral. Then number two, national, subnational. And so, because we have been very active in all this space, we have engaged all other sectors. For the past 2 years, we have been remotely trying to work with the World Health Organization through very indirect ways, but it has not been very effective. And so, this year is really a watershed year for us in terms of really trying to drive climate and health agenda in these conversations. And very, very impressed that the key health platforms in Africa have really been very active. And for Pagia, what we want and what we can promise, and you have seen our commitment, is really we are very committed to work with you, because if you hear, listen here for the past 3 days, the message has been, let us work in collaboration. No one can solve the climate problem alone. We should stop working in silos, because there is a lot of silo working, whether in every sector. And now that we are starting this journey with the health sector, the health communities, we need to bring them together, and we need to work with them together. We need to encourage them not to work in silos, because we are not going to achieve what we want. I know from Malawi, we have ended, even ahead of that, we end our relay meeting in Rwanda, where we started picking up. And all that momentum which has been built should not end with the COP. Because some people think that the COP is the end in itself. No, in fact, this is the beginning. So whether you are in Africa, I know we are building linkages beyond Africa. But as we leave the COP28, I believe that we are going to really sit down with my brother here, Gitai, Hamref, Afdep, the ministries of environment in Africa and ministries of health, and come consolidate ourselves. We can have that only a strong voice in this, I call forest, this conversation. You can see, even, I know why Gitai has come late. I don't want to say why. I know he's telling me that he was late. But I know by the time we find this forest here, this part of the forest, he is late. That is what has been happening. I normally call this a forest, because it's so huge that if you don't find the bearing, my friend, you are going to leave. After 12 days, you will not have even landed here. That is actually the situation. And so, when we come here, we consolidate ourselves, that is when we can have our voice. So, my challenge to ourselves, whether you are in the government, whether you are in the civil society in Africa, whether you are anywhere, we need to work together. The challenge is so enormous that you cannot confront it alone. My brother here, Sam, is from the African Union. We want to see how the Department of Agriculture, Rural Environment, and Sustainable Development is working with the CDC, Africa CDC. We need even interdepartmental collaborations. We are so much detached from each other that even at that corner, no one knows what the other one is doing, even if we are in the same government. These are challenges we are confronting in Africa. It is not only in the health sector. It is all over. We need to learn really to work together. And if we can work together, I can tell you we are not going to be having challenges here. Finally, it is about money, and it is about sector. What we have been confronting again is, if we unlock all the resources for the health sector, for instance, where will that money go? That's a very fundamental question. Before this event, we had an event on loss and damage and what this means for Africa. And for us in Africa, as we drive this agenda, we need to understand that we need to link, and we have been in discussion with the African group of negotiators. And so we need to align on that. How? The priorities for Africa is adaptation and adaptation finance. How are we going to ensure that we adapt the health systems in Africa and build their resilience in Africa? And so when we are discussing this, then we need really to look at that bigger picture, so that we don't disappear into the global narratives on how they define this. One is that when we talk about that, we need first and foremost energy for medicine and food preservation. I don't want to talk about so much science today. I'll veer off that because I know our ministers have talked about that. Of course, health people here are here, but it is the process which is very important, which is going to deliver us there. And so if we want to the medicine, when there was COVID-19, when was there was COVID-19? I know Gitai was very active in that, and I think we need to learn a lot from really how we confronted COVID-19 and use that mobilization prowess to do that. But what I want to say is that they could not deliver medicine in some places because of lack of health or lack of energy systems, because our energy systems are centralized. And so as we confront this, of course, we need really to challenge this issue of energy access. So you can see all these things are interconnected. The Minister of Health is saying that if we do not have decentralized, people-centered, affordable health system at very local level, even if we adopt all the Malawi Declaration, it is not going to help us. So, you know, all these sectors are interconnected. And this is why, as we convene at national level, at continental level, at the African Union, we need really to see how we can connect this. The good thing is that we have those platforms now. We have these practices. We just need to ensure that we polish them and we are able to drive this process the way it is supposed to be. So thank you very much once again for this collaboration. And for us as PAGJA, get our commitment that we are really going to be part of this to the last mile. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mithika, for your thoughts around some of the work the civil society has been doing. Let me now invite Modi Mwasama, who is the head of capacity and field development at Wellcome Trust. And Wellcome Trust has been supporting a lot of our engagement, including the African Common Position in Malawi. So we're happy to have you here just to speak to us a bit of the role of evidence in supporting this advocacy work and part of some of the lessons that you already have. I know for the remaining panelists, you know, time is far much spent, but I'm sure we can still make use of the remaining minutes to just hammer the points home. Thank you so much. Welcome.
Thank you so much for the invitation to be here. We are delighted to have supported the development of this African Common Position. Wellcome Trust, for those of you who don't know, we're a research funder. We are investing £100 million a year to help tackle the climate change and health challenge because, as we've heard, the climate crisis is a health crisis. Within our climate and health strategy, we're funding evidence to really help generate solutions which are context-specific that can really help protect people from the effects of climate change and build resilience for them to be able to have better health as climate change continues. Examples of some of the research we're funding are better understanding the impacts of climate change, who is vulnerable. One of the ministers we heard from, for example, was talking about how mental health is increasing from climate change. Farmers are losing their livelihoods. That has an impact on their mental health. But then also, during, for instance, heat waves, episodes of schizophrenia, psychosis events increase, and you also see things like an increase in domestic violence against mothers and women in particular. The health systems today aren't really set up to capture the impacts of climate change on health. So while things like psychotic episodes might be increasing, mothers during heat waves might be giving birth early, the health systems aren't capturing these climate change effects on the health system and on people's health, and therefore are not then thinking about what are the solutions to help prevent these effects of health on the populations. So we're funding research to really better understand how climate change is affecting people's health. Better understanding the problem then leads to the solutions, which is the other area where evidence is needed to really ensure that the limited resources we have to tackle climate change and health on the continent is used as effectively as possible. So the way we fund research into solutions is really ensuring that that evidence is co-produced. We don't just fund researchers on their own. We want the researchers to connect and collaborate with the civil society advocates, with the communities, with those who are responsible for communicating the impacts of climate change to the people. so that as the research is being generated, it's ensuring that it is relevant to those who are affected, to those who are in positions of responsibility and who hold the power to make decisions, that the research is supporting their needs. For example, understanding the cost effectiveness of interventions is a really important priority for us within Wellcome. We're currently scoping how we might best invest in the continent. So we've got a series of consultation activities. We're here open and ready to listen, to hear from you around how we can better invest to really support that co-production of research and evidence. The final area I'll end on in terms of how we are supporting our strategy is really ensuring that there's a diversity of African voices, African scientists coming to these global UN processes, both in terms of the advocacy. So we're delighted to see this common African position, which will hopefully influence the final text that emerges from here. But then also in the associated UNFCCC scientific process that is happening, they're going to start recruiting scientists from the beginning of next year. We want more scientists involved in that process, more science that is generated in Africa, feeding into those global policy prioritization efforts. So we're also designing investments to work out how can we best support African scientists and African science to influence the global agendas and priorities that are being driven. So if you have ideas and suggestions for those on us, please also come and speak to us. So I'll end there. The most important thing, message I want to say in terms of the lesson we're learning, research is important to identifying where to invest, but research that's designed by researchers on its own is not going to lead to impact. So all the research that we fund in the African continent, we really want to see it co-produced with the research users, with the NGOs, the civil society, the affected communities. And that's where all of you are important from all the different sectors to really collaborate to help solve this climate and health challenge. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. We are moving towards the end. I just want to give Natasha just 1 minute to speak to us around how the African Group of Negotiators.
Okay.
Just 1 minute.
Okay.
You can summarize.
Good afternoon. I won't take much of your time because I note that the next meeting is starting. So we apologize for the delay. We were held up for another 30 minutes as well. So on the Africa Group of Negotiators, just very quickly, we are framing the message on health and climate under what is known as the Global Goal and Adaptation, which I know many of us are aware of. So coming in from Lilongwe leading up to now, the Africa Group of Negotiators, obviously at COP28, we could not introduce a new agenda item on health and climate because it is extremely difficult to bring an agenda item on the COP agenda in a period of 6 months. So as the Africa Group of Negotiators, we have identified health as one of the targets which will be considered for the framing of the Global Goal on Adaptation, and this will be